A couple other things before we transition. First, some of you may not know this, it is Mr. Helton's birthday. Our little boy's growing up. He's becoming a big boy, so make sure to tell him happy birthday today. And also, Bob's going to share something with us at this time.
How about Greg Appreciation Day? Every Sunday, huh? That's not easy coming up here and asking for money, but it is. Hey, in case you haven't heard, Tuesday there's an election. For those of you who have a phone, what? Tuesday is election day, all right? So if you would, right now, just take a look to your right. Take a look to your right, and take a look to your left. And now, take a look behind you. Some of these people bite, but don't be afraid. Okay, if you don't vote Tuesday, they're going to vote for you. Right? So that means you don't really have a stake in what's going on. Even worse is, if you don't vote, your crazy Uncle Earl's going to vote. You know, the one who's married to Earlene, the fourth wife, still thinks Ronald Reagan is the president of the United States? All right, he's going to vote for you, and they're going to decide your life and your future. So get out there and vote, because it does matter. Every one of those votes do matter, okay? So you got to do that. Now, I'm going to tell you right now, this is going to probably be the most partisan political speech you'll ever hear, and I'm going to give it to you today. So put aside right now if you're a Democrat, and put aside if you're a Republican. Just listen to me, if you would. I'm going to tell you about my candidate. Right now, he's not leading in the polls, but he's part of this election. And has been part of this every election since we started having him. Okay? My candidate is Jesus Christ. And what you have to do when you look at candidates is to find out who they are. Not what they are on television, not what they are in those little folders that come in the mail, but who they really are. Not who, just because they have a great mommy and daddy, that I should vote for them, because there's a lot of great mommies and daddies out there, and their kids are, you know, right? Find out who they really are. Because something's going to happen Tuesday. Someone's going to get elected. There's no doubt about it, they're going to get elected, all right? What really matters is, it matters who that person that's going to be elected. What happened back in the 1960s, people decided, you know what? We're going to take secular progressivism to the United States of America. We're going to take on the Christians. And they'd go, well, this is almost impossible. How can you do that? They did it. Look at the world today. And what happens usually is the Christians stay home, or they stay quiet, all right? My candidate has a very large and well-organized campaign staff. They're sitting right here today. But unfortunately, we stay quiet. Now, here's the thing. It doesn't really matter who's going to be president in the United States. What's going to matter is who is elected here in Bell County. Do I know that person? Because once you elect that person in Bell County, if they have a gospel conscious mind and they're elected to office, well, what happens a little bit later after they've been in office? They probably decide that they want to become a state representative or a state senator. And again, they're going to take that consciousness with them to the state house. Then, maybe somewhere along the line, they might want to run for governor. So if we're electing good people in the county, and electing good people to state office, and we're electing good governors, why not go and elect good representatives to the federal government, good senators to the federal government? So when it comes time for election in the next few years, and they go to pick who, senators and governors, we have good people of conscience who we're going to vote for. Now, it took those secular progressives 50 years, but look who we have on our side. We have Jesus Christ on our side, right? That's who's going to get us there. We can do it in less than 50 years. So you talk about changing the landscape, changing this country, right? So we have to encourage not only the young people, but the adults in here. Because if you can't find anybody elective to be elected, what's wrong with you? What are y'all doing? Why don't you run for office? I'll campaign for you. I can't run for office because too many skeletons in my closet. Okay? But you can. I'll be glad to work for you. Why not? How about here on this front row? Anybody going to run for office? Anybody thinking about it? Huh? Anybody? You are? Come here. Anybody else? Hey, there's one man. One man. Future looks good, doesn't it? Because right now, you got a whole base right here. You've got campaign workers right here. You've got good teachers. You've got good teachers of morals and ethics. You've got an educator right there that will show you the way. You're going to do well, my friend. I'll vote for you. 30 years from now, president. In fact, I'll do, right? Why not? Why not? Huh? In fact, I'll do what we do in Harlan County a lot. We vote early and we vote often. But that's the way it works. That's where all these people have come from. They decided that they were going to make a stand, take on the establishment, which is us, the Christians. The Christians will stay home because we'll just overpower them. And now they can use their ideas, just using plain logic, not morals, to make sure that anything goes. But we have something that's not only logic, it's better than logic. Just down home common sense. This is what the Lord, our Savior, Jesus Christ, told us to do. So we want to do that. Can you put that verse up for me, Jacob? Okay, a hired hand will run when he sees a wolf coming. So if somebody is a politician and they're bought and paid for, he will abandon the sheep because they do not belong to him, and he isn't their shepherd. He belongs to someone else. And so the wolf attacks them and scatters the flock. The hired hand runs away because he's working for only money and doesn't really care about the sheep. That's us. I am the good shepherd, and I know my own sheep, and they know me. And if you keep going on that, not only will he say he'll take care of his own sheep, but those who are not his own sheep. Because why? We love one another. And I love that crazy secular progressive that's out there. You know why? Because they just don't know any better. Right? So, in closing, I just want to say, please vote. Look at who you're voting for, especially in the future. You know, maybe it's too late to really examine what we have, to really get to know these people that are running locally on the state level, but do it. And remember one thing. Never bow to any man or any woman, only bow to your Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen. I will be voting this Tuesday, and you should be too. Amen. So let's stand on our feet. How many is ready to worship this morning? We got about five. How many is ready to worship this morning? I don't know about you, but I am. Amen. I want to read a couple verses of scripture before we open up in a word of prayer this morning. Psalm chapter 40, verses 1 through 4, says, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me out of a horrible pit and out of the miry clay. He set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. He's put a new song in my mouth, He's put a new song in my mouth, even praise to our God. Many will see it. Didn't say hear it. Many will see it in fear and will trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man that makes the Lord his trust and respects not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. I believe that God is putting a new song in our mouths today to give God the praise and the glory that he deserves. And people will see it and will be amazed at what God is doing in the earth. Can anybody say amen to that? Isaiah chapter 26, verse number 3. The word says, you will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed upon you because he trusts in you. There's a theme on this, trusting in the Lord. Verse 4, trust in the Lord forever, for in the Lord Jehovah is everlasting strength. So this morning, what I want to speak over everyone in this room today is that perfect peace is coming on you. I said perfect peace is coming on you. Perfect peace is coming on you whose mind is on the Lord. I believe a new song is coming in your mouth to give God praise, and the Lord will be your strength. Somebody needs to receive that today. And I'm going to keep saying it for just a few moments till somebody gets it that needs it. Perfect peace is coming on you whose mind is upon the Lord. He is your strength, the Lord Jehovah. He is your strength. There's a new song coming. I feel authority in me. There's a new song coming in your mouth today. There's a new song coming in your mouth, and many will see it and know that he is God. He's taking you out of the miry pit, and he is setting your feet upon a rock to stay. He will establish your goings. Perfect peace is coming on you whose mind is constantly upon the Lord. He is Jehovah and he is your strength. He will establish your feet upon the rock. He's taking you out of the miry clay. He's taking you out of sinking sand. He is putting your feet upon a rock to stay. He will establish your goings. Perfect peace is coming on you whose mind is upon the Lord. Can anybody put their eyes and set their gaze upon Jesus? Is there anyone in this room that says, I've been sinking, I've been battling, I've been weary, but this morning I am setting my feet upon the rock of Jesus Christ? Come on, throw your hands up in the air. Throw your hands up in the air. Let's worship him. Jesus, we love you and we bless you. You are our rock. You are our strength. You are our fortress. Father, our minds are upon you. And God, I declare a new song is coming. You're releasing the voice of the mountains, oh God. I pray, let your fire burn. I pray that we are unified before you and that we're not in sinking sand, but we're upon the solid rock. Abba, we trust you. We trust you. You brought us too far to leave us. God, we trust you as the author and the finisher of our faith. No weapon formed against us shall be able to prosper. Our minds are upon you, and perfect peace is covering us today. Let your glory come. God, show us your glory. Show us your glory. Show us your glory. God, come and have your way. Come and have your way, Abba. Lord, we put our trust in you. Perfect peace. Perfect peace. Covering the earth. Covering the earth. Hallelujah. Come on. Lift your worship. Lift the praise to the Lord. Come on. Give God a shout. Come on.
See you. Yes, Lord, is righteous and holy and worthy. I'm a singer. Righteous, yeah, holy, yeah, holy, yeah, holy.
And
He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Yes, He is.
Forever. The author of salvation. Oh. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered.
Bow before the Lion and the Lamb, and every knee will bow.
can stop the Lord Almighty? Nothing. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Who can stop the Lord Almighty? No one. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Nothing, no. Who can stop the Lord?
The snare is broken, and we have escaped. I come to serve notice. I come to serve notice on the enemy of our souls. That the snare is broken, and we have escaped. By the help of the Lord and by the name of the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, pray that the enemy of our souls will be ensnared in his own snare. And that he will fall into the pit that he has dug for our feet. In the name of Jesus, I declare your people are victorious. We are victorious because you are victorious. We will not be defeated. The snare is broken, and we have escaped by the help of the Lord. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name, I declare it. I declare it. In Jesus' name, you are for your people, Jesus. You are for us, so who can be against us?
Victorious.
every time he heard my cry.
None like you, Lord. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you that you are called faithful and true. Thank you, Father, that you are faithful even when we are not. You're so good. Come on, just one more moment. Can you tell him right now? You're a faithful Father. Jesus. We love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. Somebody say he's good. Look at your neighbor and say he's good. Thank you, worship team. You guys can be seated this morning. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Brandon's going to come and share the word for us this morning, so come on up, man. Let's give Brandon a hand. Do you love Brandon?
Praise the Lord. I feel the presence of Jesus in this place. Isn't it awesome that when we're going through things, the best remedy is Him, His presence. So sweet, so comforting, amen? I want you to do something real quick. I want you to place your hand on your heart, anyone, and in your loudest voice so you can hear yourself, I want you to say, this word is for me. Justin said something very profound Thursday that changed my life when he said, what if we would go back and every word we heard, we would say, this word is for me. And that just really grabbed my attention. How many of you believe that God wants, that Jesus wants a prosperous church to walk in power and in demonstration of the Spirit here on earth? Amen? Amen? Do you really believe that? Do you really believe that? I believe it too, and through the Word we're going to show you. I'm just going to take a couple of moments because I believe the Holy Spirit is beckoning us and calling us to greater. Turn to Matthew chapter 11. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Matthew chapter 11. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you today to share the word that you have given me to your people, Lord. Father, I pray today they may not even hear my voice, but that they may hear the voice of many waters. Father, I pray that you prepare our hearts, you prepare our mind, in the name of Jesus to receive the word. Father, I rebuke the foul spirit of pride right now in Jesus' name. I pray that a spirit of humility, Lord, may just be upon your people in Jesus' name. Some of you heard it and were like, oh my goodness, why did he pray that? I believe God's trying to get us to a certain place to be effective, an effective body in his kingdom. So John chapter 11, I'll be quick. I promise I'm not a long-winded speaker. I'm the type of person that when the Holy Spirit says to shut up, I move out of the way. That's the way that I am. But Matthew chapter 11, I'm not like that off the pulpit, though. I can talk your ear off. Try me. I'll try. Praise the Lord. All right, Matthew chapter 11, verse 7. And these were going away, Jesus began to speak to the multitude about John. What did you go out into the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by the wind? That's a question he asked. But what did you go out to see? A man dressed in soft clothing? Behold, those who wear soft clothing are in king's palaces. But why did you go out? To see a prophet? Yes, I say to you, and one who is more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you. Truly I say to you, among those born of women, there has not arisen anyone greater than John the Baptist. Yet he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence, and the violent men take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you care to accept it, he himself is Elijah, who was to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. Let's stop right there for just a moment. And I want to talk about something that's mentioned a lot, but you don't see a lot of it in the church, and it's the virtue of humility. It's a commodity that's priceless because it gets you places, but you don't see it in the church a lot. So I want to show you through Scripture where humility can get you to. Listen, you will never be more powerful in the Spirit than operating in the anointing that God has specifically placed over your life. And you know what? The anointing is not, it's unusual for every single person. God does not desire 10 million Benny Hinn's running around this earth. God does not desire, I believe, 10 million Rod Parsley's running around the earth. I know for a fact that I'm not called, I'm not anointed to be a head pastor. I'm not. My compassion pump is broken. My patience container is leaking. I don't have the what's needed, the elements to be a pastor. And if I would ever step out of the calling that God has placed upon my life and try to step into another anointing that I'm not called to operate in, I would find myself in a hard place struggling. You know what my calling is? To submit to this man sitting right in front. I know what my position is. And me trying to operate anywhere outside of what God has called me to do would see me as a failure. Now, anybody can be a great orator and stand behind a pulpit and give you a beautifully constructed message, but it doesn't mean that there's anointing upon it. Listen, talent does not mean anointing. Position does not mean anointing. Your talents and your position can send you straight to hell. But pursuing the desire and the will of God is what He wants for each and every one of us. That is what He desires. He doesn't desire us to be like any other person. He has called us to individuality. We are to be individual in the eyes of God. The anointing that I recognize in my life does not crave human influence. It craves, I know that I have heavenly influence, because that's what my anointing does. I believe I can get a hold of God in prayer. And when you seek more human influence than heavenly influence, you'll find yourself just posting sporadic statuses on social media, getting about 50 to 60 likes. And that's the scope of what you'll get. But when you line up according to what God desires for your life, your influence will go far beyond what you can imagine. Far beyond what you can imagine. Let me show you something in Scripture. We all think about John, and we know about John, and you probably, what I'm going to tell you today, you probably have already heard, but that's okay, because I'm not here to wow you with my 2-cent revelation that I believe I have. I'm a man who preaches the word. I read the word, and if that doesn't make you excited and make you awe and wonder inside and jump for Jesus, I don't know what will. I'm not here to try to break, to try to give you the most awesome, newest revelation, because God is speaking and that's enough for me. So let's look at John. Who was John? Let's look at this real quick. John, if you look at Luke 1:5, this is Zechariah, John's father, who's doing his priestly duties before the throne, in the temple before the Lord, and Gabriel shows up. Right, if you look at Luke 1:5, if you want to put it up there real quick, if you can, it doesn't matter if you don't. But just for those that may not have the word, Luke 1:5, the Bible says, there was a priest in the time of Herod who was of the division of Abijah. The thing about Luke, if you read every other gospel, it seems like just a quick summary, but Luke was very detailed. And there's a reason why Luke was very detailed, because he wants you to grasp the importance of who John the Baptist, Zechariah, and Jesus were. So he says, he was from the division of Abijah. Well, who is Abijah? Abijah is an ancestor of Aaron, the high priest. If you look in 1 Chronicles 24, it talks about David set up 24 different divisions of Levitical priests under the ancestors of Aaron. What we know that Nadab and Abihu offered strange fire before God. Therefore, they were destroyed. And two sons of Aaron were left, Eleazar and Ithamar. And the Bible tells us in 1 Chronicles 24 that David set up 24 divisions because there were so many descendants from Aaron, he had to set up shifts and they had to cast lots. So if you read on 1 Chronicles 24, the lot of Abijah was the eighth lot, right? So we find Zechariah right before Jesus is even born. They're still following the structure that King David set up in 1 Chronicles 24. This is going to get exciting. You probably heard this before, but this just blows my mind. So all of a sudden, he's burning incense and offering prayer before the Lord. And Gabriel shows up out of nowhere. I know it ain't Christmas season yet, but stick with me. You're going to understand what I'm trying to say. Gabriel shows up, and he's just like, you will have a son. And he begins to tell Zechariah how his son will be great in the sight of the Lord. And he releases unto Zechariah the fact that John will be a Nazarite. He will refrain from drink. He will be great in the sight of the Lord. Then all of a sudden, fast forward to the adulthood of John, and you find John a grown man. But where do you find him at? You find him in the wilderness. This man had a wilderness anointing, and we know this. He disappears to the wilderness, and people might, and this is what got me. John had every right to battle for the position of high priest in the time of Jesus because he was an Aaronic priest. By the time that Jesus showed up on the scene, the high priest position was a political position which Caesar chose. And people might say, well, the enemy came around and destroyed the plan of God. No, he didn't, because God had a greater plan than that. What would have happened if John, instead of pursuing the will of God and what God had desired for him to do, pursued the high priestly position in the times of Jesus? I don't think he would have done half of what the Bible records he would have done. If he would have pursued his rightful positions as an Aaronic priest. Let me show you what happens. The Bible tells us that whenever John, listen, it just blows my mind. I'm sorry, my mind is everywhere. I have notes all over the place, so it's going to come out somehow. But John was so submitted to the will of God that he didn't pursue his rightful position that should have been his, because God had greater for him to do. You know, in Leviticus chapter 8, whenever Aaron was consecrated as priest, the Bible says that he was washed with water. That Hebrew word wash is rahat, which means bathed. Fast forward to the New Testament, you see John the Baptist baptizing Jesus in the River Jordan. And what he did, because he submitted to the will of God, he transferred the priesthood to Jesus, because he knew that Jesus was going to be the great high priest that would pray for us, that would forgive our sins, and that would come from the line of Melchizedek that has no end. What if John would have done his own thing and said, I deserve this position. This is my rightful position. He would have began to operate in an anointing that God never called him to. But God had a greater redemptive plan for John. He went out into the wilderness, not seeking fame, not seeking fortune, not seeking human influence. He detested it. He detested the priesthood. He called the Pharisees and the Sadducees broods of vipers. But yet, he was so anointed that God began to send people to him. And he began to preach the doctrine of repentance before anyone else had preached it in that time. He began to call man unto repentance. And that's why Jesus called him one of the greatest people that have ever touched the face of this planet. This is nothing. I'm not trying to wow you with my revelation. I'm just trying to get you to the place to understand that God has called you to a specific purpose. And if you find yourself trying to do something other than that, you're going to fail. You're going to fail. Because you're not walking in what God wants you to walk in. Do you know that whether you have a position on the music team, whether you're a pastor or a deacon, whether you take up offering, whether you stand up here and dance, your sole worry in your position is to point people to Jesus. That's it. It's not to get up here and say, oh, look how well I can play an instrument, or look how well I can dance, look how high I can kick, look everything that I can do. No, it's pointing people to Jesus, because Jesus is the highest thing that ever known to man. That is our one mission and purpose in our walk with Jesus, in everything that we do. And I'm not just talking about church position. If you're a banker, if you're a teacher, wherever you work, your number one priority is to point people to Jesus. Because if it wasn't for him, you wouldn't be in that position in the first place. You wouldn't be in that position in the first place. John could have done anything he wanted to, but he wanted to be smack in the center of God's will. Let me tell you how awesome were this place John at. Do you realize that every man, every prophet up to the time of John only foresaw the day of Christ from far away, but John was able to witness the dawn of it? Isaiah only saw Christ from far away. Ezekiel, when he saw a man sitting on the throne above the earth, was only able to see Jesus from far away. But what I tell you is John was able to see the day dawn, and out of his mouth came, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes the sin of the world away." Could he have done that if he would have been high priest? Could he have done that if he pursue position rather than anointing, position rather than the purpose of God upon his life? I don't think so. And he pursued the Lord as best as he could. Even in the face of death, he rejoiced the fact that the Messiah. A lot of people read John chapter 11, they're like, oh, John doubted Jesus. No, he didn't. He was pleased to know that the works of Christ were being done. That's why Jesus rebuked the crowd and said, "What did you come and see? A reed shaken by the wind?" No, if you looked at a hurricane and when a huge Category 4, it literally bends these trees. But he wasn't that way. He was a man that was strong in the spirit because he knew his position. When you know your identity and your anointing and what God has called you to do, no man can make you waver. No man, no word of criticism, no tongue that's raised in judgment can bring you down from where you're at, because you know who you are in Jesus. That's just the way that it is. But you have to make sure that you are walking in the calling that God has placed upon your life. Because you're under the covering in what God has called you to do. Not only that, but there's a little bit of something in the church that I believe the church needs to read about. It's a little something called spiritual authority. And if you don't respect it, don't expect for people to respect you. Jesus set it up for a reason. That's why John and James are called the son of thunder, but they were some of the most hot-headed men out there. They said, you know what? They asked Jesus, "Should we call down fire upon them?" And Jesus said no, and they submitted to him. When you honor the anointing that's above you, God will honor your anointing. God will honor you, and I'm not afraid to preach this. It's the truth. It's in Scripture. It's in Scripture. Look what happened in John chapter 11. John's disciples come and ask Jesus if he's the one, or should they look for another? And he says, "Tell them the works of Christ. The blind are healed. The poor have the gospel preached to them." Then the disciples leave, and guess what happens? Jesus begins to testify about John. When your anointing testifies about Jesus, Jesus will have no problem testifying about you. That's why if you look in Matthew, he called John a burning and a shining lamp, because he understood where John was and how submitted John was. The anointings, plural, in this house will make room for one another if we are submitted to the cause of Christ. If we are submitted to Jesus wholeheartedly, God will make room for all the anointing and talent in this place. Guys, we have such this area. I didn't come here for no reason. God placed me in this place because I was promised to see revival and awakening. You might call all these fires burning in this mountain just an accident, but I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt, the Lord is trying to tell us something. There's a spiritual significance to what's happening. And if we submit to what God desires for us, we will see ourselves in a place that we can never imagine. But we must submit to what God desires. We must submit to the anointing that God has placed upon our lives. I gave you the formula right here in Scripture that when you submit and you align to the will of God, you will do great exploits that you can't do on your own. And then Jesus goes on to say, after he talks about John and begins to testify about John, he begins to go against the religious crowd that was criticizing and that wasn't pleased with either John or him. These were indifferent Christians, indifferent Jews that had no desire but were the first to criticize. He said, John came not eating and not drinking. Otherwise, he came, in other words, he came as a Nazarite, and you said he has a demon. Jesus, he said, I came eating and drinking, and you call him a glutton and a drunkard, the one who eats with sinners. And then he says, to whom should I liken this generation but unto children who are sitting in the marketplace? And he begins to say, we played the flute for you and you did not dance. We sang you a dirge and you did not mourn. What he's trying to say was his generation was indifferent. Indifferent to what was going on in their day. They were lackadaisical. They were just sitting there wasting their time. Don't be one of those people who have no desire to do anything for God, but you're the first one to criticize. Don't. You have no right. You have no right because you're not doing anything. Because you're not doing it. It's just like when we go out to vote. If you don't vote, don't complain of who gets elected because you didn't go out and voice your opinion and do something about it. Nobody will ever understand your unusual anointing. Because it's not theirs to operate in. And those, it's just like John operated as a Nazarite and he went out into the wilderness and people went to go chase him. And he operated under the anointing that God called him to be and people began to criticize him. Because people criticize what they don't understand and what they don't know. They don't see you in your secret place in the closet praying to the Lord, fasting, seeking the face of God. They don't see that. They don't see the sacrifice that you made to operate under the anointing that you do. They don't understand it because they haven't paid a price for it. And it's not valuable to them. Quit getting upset when something happens against your anointing. Let the Lord vindicate you. Let the Lord vindicate you because the anointing will speak for itself. The anointing will speak for itself. And I say this in all love. Listen. There's a world out there dying without Jesus. There's a world, there's young kids who I teach in high school who are dealing with a lot of mess. There's kids who are committing suicide out there because nobody has ever told them that Jesus loves them and the church is not being the church. The church is not being the church. How can we sit back and complain that the world is in some certain condition when we're not even broken when the loss of life happens? You know, one of the dirtiest, most horrible things I saw this year when the Orlando shooting happened, I saw Christians commending the attack of dead men and women who were homosexual. Well, saying, well, that's what they get. No. Because in the eyes of God, there was still a soul who was in need of salvation. We got this whole spiritual elitism thing going on. That I think I'm spiritually elite and I've made it and I know I've arrived and it's up to somebody else to go and to reach the lost. When that's not even the fact that God wants. That's not even the truth. We must submit to the direct alignment of the will of the Father. That's just the way that it is. There's no other way. No other way but this way. Submitting to what the Lord desires us to do. Listen, I don't want to spend the rest of my life in the permissible will of God when I can be in His perfect will. I don't want to get to the point when I get to heaven and for some reason I couldn't make it because I chose my own desires and my own way while still trying to get into the kingdom of God when He had a greater plan, a greater purpose for me. I don't desire that. I don't desire that. I want to do what God has called me to do. And God is calling us to humility. That's why Jesus said, if you humble yourself, the Lord will exalt you. Man, Peter said, humble yourself under the mighty hand of God that He may exalt you at the right time. You know what? Do you know what Jesus said? In Scripture, He said, if you are least than John, you'll be greater in heaven. I guarantee that there is grandmothers and grandfathers and people who never once stepped on a platform who will have a greater level of glory than John the Baptist did. Because they cared not for the platform. They cared not for human influence. They only had a desire to please the Father. And that's what was their daily drive on a daily basis. I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt, my grandmother will be one of those counted as the greatest in heaven. Never once did she step up on a platform, but that woman prayed. And when you called her, she would stop what she was doing, go to her closet and get on her face. Even if her arthritis never allowed her to, she would, because she knew that when she opened her mouth, God would listen to her. Humble yourself. Walk in humility. Let the anointing speak for itself. Let the fruit speak for itself. You don't got to point to yourself to see how great you are. We know you're great, or so you think. Let Jesus testify about you. Let the Lord be the one to say, Brandon was a burning and a shining lamp. Odie was a burning and a shining lamp. Do you see my daughter right there? I am so proud of her because she submits herself to me. Humility is the number one thing that'll get us through our Christian walk. To submit ourselves to what God desires. This might not be, I mean, y'all are quiet and that's okay. I'd rather you not clap for me if you're not going to agree, because when you say amen or when you clap, you're saying yes and you're agreeing to what I'm saying. I don't care about the protocol of preaching, so if you're just going to say it, don't say it at all, because I'm not here to please you. I'm here to do what Jesus is calling us to do. And Jesus is calling us to be greater, to say, get up. There's work to do. There's people out there who are dying. There's a harvest out there. The anointing will make room for itself if you just submit to what I'm calling you to do. If you just do what I'm calling you to do. What kind of legacy do you want to leave? What kind of testimony do you want to leave in your Christian walk? What do you desire for people to say about you when the Lord calls your number and you go on to rest in His glory? What do you want people to say? I'm going to leave that question to you. So I'm done. If the musicians want to come up, we're going to take some time, and you know what? We're going to pray. Because each and every one of us has the ability right now to search our hearts. To search our hearts, because baby, you can hide as much as you want to, but the Holy Ghost will expose you exactly as He wants. He is a light that shines and exposes the darkest place of your heart. So we're going to pray today. That's what we're going to do. And we're going to ask the Holy Spirit to examine our hearts. And if there's no humility in here, you know what? Guess what? God is a God of grace and mercy. He can fill you up, baby. And you can leave this place more humble than you came in. We got too much to do in this community. Too many people who are addicted to drugs. Too many people who are addicted to pornography. Too many young kids who have been abandoned by parents and are looking for a father figure and a mother figure to lead them in the righteous path. We have too many people out there for the church. And I'm not just talking about us, for the church overall in this county to not be doing what God has called us to do. I was talking with Sarah and with Miranda, and I started talking about there is over 700 to 800 churches in this county. And there's a demographic that came out that there's about 5,000 people or so, 4,000 to 5,000 people who do not claim to have any religious affiliation in this county. And we began to do the math, and we said if each church would focus on 7.5 people, 7 grown adults and kids and a baby, if they would focus on 7.5 people, theoretically all of Bell County would be saved. If each one of those 700 churches would focus on just 7 people, I can name to you 7 people who work with me who may not know Jesus. Do we want to see our county saved? Do we want to see the glory of God manifested in this region? Do we want to see the hand of God move through this church in a way that we have never expected before? It starts by humbling ourselves and submitting ourselves to the Father. Every person standing up if you're able to. We're about to pray. I don't know how you felt about this word or how you received it, and honestly, I don't care. I speak the truth. And I love this body of believers too much. This body of believers too much to allow the adversary to come in and to try to destroy the church that I call family and that I love. I pray for this church on a daily basis because I love you like family. I have never been part of a church in my entire life when I can walk in and I feel the love of a family over me. Never in my life. And that's what draws people to this place, that when they come in, they are loved. We have people out there who are hurting. We have people out there who are in need of Jesus. And we are to be a hospital to the sick and to show them Jesus and to show them who he is and what he can do for their lives. Each one of us has a calling of what to operate in this place. I don't care if I would ever step foot up in this platform again, because I told you, I know where my calling is at. I know what I'm supposed to do, and I know that when I open my mouth, there's bowls in heaven being filled, and at any moment, God's about to release what I've been praying over this region. Humility, humility, humility. You know what? Were you prideful? It's okay. It's okay. God doesn't want you to be prideful. He's full of mercy and he's full of grace. So I'm opening up this altar for each and every one of you. I can't force all of you to come, but you know what? I'm going to be right here as well. But you think it's easy to preach something like this? It's not. But God wants to take us to a place that we've never been before. He doesn't want us just to have yearly conferences and to be all good for 4 days and then all of a sudden it ends and it seems like we're at a funeral again. He doesn't desire that. So let's pray. I challenge you to come. If you don't want to come up here, find a place to kneel down and pray at and ask the Lord, Father, show me where I have messed up. Show me where I've gotten prideful. Show me where I have not been humble at. Come on, let's pray.